I'm Roland Barton, and welcome to this special edition of News One Now. Is school choice the black choice? School choice simply means that parents can choose the right school for their kids, traditional public schools, public charter schools, private schools, religious schools, even the use of vouchers. Right now, there's a raging controversy over school choice in America, but especially among African Americans. Supporters of school choice argue that traditional public schools have failed our kids miserably. That charter schools and choice are crucial to the future of black children in the black community. Plus, our survey last year, black parents found an overwhelming majority want the choice to send their kids to charter schools or get a voucher to help pay for a private or religious school. Opponents of school choice, including the NAACP and the Congressional Black Caucus, claim that charter schools and vouchers result in unregulated, substandard schools, disrupt our communities, and siphon off needed monies from underfunded public school systems. So we convened 16 educators, advocates, and experts to share their views with parents and teachers, as well as students, at a town hall here in Washington, D.C., on the campus of Howard University. All this against the backdrop of the move by the NAACP board to ratify a resolution calling for a moratorium on the opening of any new charter schools. Hello, folks. I'm Roland Martin, and welcome to this town hall. Is school choice the black choice? We're here on the campus of Howard University. One of the reasons we chose this location because Howard is the only HBCU in America with a charter school. And so we wanted to be able to... And so we want to thank President Dr. Wayne Frederick for allowing us to actually be here. Thank you so very much. And so this is what we want to do. And the reason I want to do this is because this is a controversial issue, that is, of school choice, ed reform. And when it comes to African Americans, I wanted to have a black conversation. All the panelists are black. All the experts are black. And the reason being because when you look at what's happening with education in this country, for the first time last year, 51% of all kids in public schools were black and brown. We're not going backwards, we're going forward. So the real question is, does school choice make sense for African Americans? And so we look forward to this spirited conversation. We've got some phenomenal experts, advocates, and educators, folks on both sides of the issue. So let's get with it, please. Welcome our panel. Steve Perry, I'll start with you. Why is the NAACP wrong, and why are you right?
The NAACP, well, first of all, thank you, Roland, for having this event. Folks, give it up for Roland for pulling us together. And big ups to you for coming out to have a conversation about education in the black community. It just shows how much we all care, regardless of what side we are, the issue. The reason why the NAACP is wrong is because, like so many other government systems, the public education system has failed the black community. It's not just a school-to-prison pipeline, it's a school-to-prison superhighway. If you look very quickly, you'll see that our children are some 12% of the population in many of the school systems, yet we make up 40% of the children who are expelled. Our children are three and a half times as likely to be suspended. They make up 70% of those arrested in the schools. Only 68% of them in many states will ever graduate. And in fact, what you ultimately find is that those people who end up in prison tend to be the ones who go to the schools that are the failure factories. And so what we find is that the traditional public school system has failed us miserably and continues to do so. If it were being successful, then there would be no such thing as a charter school today. In fact, the reason why there is choice is because that which we had was insufficient. And take it finally one step here. At the current rate of growth, within a traditional school system, it would take African Americans 286 years to close the achievement gap. If all we did was give every single black child, only black child, access to the highest quality instructors, that being the top 25%, we could close that achievement gap, according to Harvard researchers, in 8 years. And then the final part is this. Over 700,000 black people have made it abundantly clear that their parents, and they don't need the NAACP or any local officials telling them where to send their children to school.
Hillary Shelton, representative of the NAACP. We also invited out Cornell Brooks, the president and CEO, but he had other obligations, so certainly glad to have you here. Why did the NAACP, national body, pass this resolution at its convention? Why do they want a national moratorium?
Thank you very much, and I really appreciate having this conversation. Since we passed this resolution, one of the things that's been most fascinating to me is that I'm not convinced that a lot of people's responses understand what the definition of moratorium means. Moratorium means we have to stop for a minute. The way we recognize that over the last 15 years, we've seen a growth in charter schools that in somewhere between 300 to 700 per year, as we've seen that growth. The challenge is that they don't have very much oversight. There is very little focus on what they're doing and how they're doing it. And quite frankly, what we've seen in some cases, now don't get me wrong, the bottom line for the NAACP is we want high quality education for all of our children. We want to make sure they have what they need, whether it's a public school. Don't forget, we've never had a problem suing public schools either, taking them all the way to the Supreme Court when necessary. If they're not providing the services we need for our children, then we're going to have to address that. And we'll utilize the courts, we'll utilize elections and everything else to address those concerns. What we've seen in these cases is African-American children are not graduating at a faster rate from charter schools than they are from public schools. What we also know is that the oversight that's provided for charter schools is much less. We have charter schools, believe it or not, that actually hire teachers that don't even have bachelor's degrees. They hire teachers that don't even have certification. So in essence, if you're going to talk about high quality and you're talking about the problems we have in the public schools, let's talk about that because there are plenty of problems there. But let's at least use those standards as the lower standards and shoot for something higher. Should we not have better facilities, better teachers, better curriculums, and things that actually work? Now, I know some charter schools that work just fine, and we're very proud of those as well. But the truth of the matter is, we've got schools right here, even in Washington, D.C., that I can tell you the teachers don't have degrees, they don't have certification, and I can tell one, I'm not going to name names, but I can tell you about one in which the head of the school actually gave herself a Ph.D. We know we have problems. We want to solve that. Let's stop for a minute. Let's look at what's going on. Let's make sure the resources are utilized in a way that's going to be most helpful, that our children are going to do the best they possibly can. And we see, of course, the last thing I'll say, Roland, look, we know education is that bridge over troubled water. It's that ladder out of poverty. We cannot allow people to play with our education systems so they can make riches for themselves. We need good schools, no matter what you want to call them.
Rudy, I want to ask you, you ran the school system in New York. To Steve's point, if traditional schools were doing their job, there wouldn't be a need for charter schools. There wouldn't be a need for school choice. Is it true or not that school choice is a reflection of the failure of traditional schools to educate our children?
Thank you again for allowing me to be here. To the point, I guess I don't see it quite that sharply. I do think that there is a relationship between the anxiety, the tension, the anger that has been part and parcel of the disruption, really, of public education, which sorely needed to happen, I might add. And to that extent, it actually did lead to the creation of more legislation and a body of work around charter schools. But I think the point that I'd want to make about this is in New York City or in Miami where I was superintendent or Sacramento where I was superintendent or Tacoma, Washington where I was superintendent, no matter where it has been, there's a third, if not more, of the children for whom that school system is basically useless. There's a third of the youngsters who are perennially left behind. Now, if I were to look at the scattergram of all the charter schools in the United States, I would tell you that you're going to find about that same representation of students who are not being served by your charter schools. You're looking at about a third of the population for whom schooling as it is currently situated is literally dysfunctional, and families are trying to figure out what to do about that. So when I was in New York, yes, there were schools that were so dysfunctional that parents said, give me anything but this. The issue is when you start talking about the but this, you have to actually start asking yourself as an educator, well, then what does it look like to have real choice in the Black community? A choice between a poor performing school and another poor performing school is no choice. A choice between a non-performing charter school and a non-performing public school is no choice. But the idea of there being choice in the Black community is, in my mind, every bit as historically valuable and as economically viable as choice within the economic market. We ought to have a market of ideas of schools that are out there, but I think to the point that was just raised, but they've got to be at a standard that represents something that really is a quality choice. Otherwise, these are just Hobson's choices. These are choices among unequals. It's a fake choice. And so when I hear people talking about the charter movement, I'm thinking, well, all right, that's 5%. That's maybe a 5% solution. You got 30%, 40% of our youngsters who are at risk. So the question of a 5% solution to a 40% problem is really, I don't know, you do the math, but I can tell you, you know, it's not going to be a system that essentially replaces the public school system. My last point about this is either you're going to have a public school system of some quality, and we're going to invest in that. We're going to invest in good teachers. We're going to invest in paying people the amount that it takes to basically get people who are certified and qualified and able to do this work in a content-rich and global world, or you're not. And the second you stop doing it, then you create little places like places in Newark or little itty-bitty enclaves in New York City and other places where the only way you can get change, the only way you can get anything in is to literally bootleg it through a charter this or a new that. In Rudy Giuliani's case, it was, let me create a voucher system. Well, you know, you see how far that got me. So all I would say is, you know, if you're talking about real choice, then make real public school choices out of public schools. Invest in those facilities, invest in those teachers, invest in the leadership, invest in the quality teaching, invest in the technology, invest in fixing the facilities up so that parents then can look at what essentially is choice A and choice B and have them be, if you will, both high quality choices.
Ramona, 2009, I'm on Air Force One with President Obama and with several members of the Black press. And I began to ask him about education. And I did ask him about school vouchers. We're going to get to that in the second hour of this conversation. And he said, Roland, I know where you're going. He said, but if every kid could go, could get a voucher, I support it. I said, well, but you support charters, every kid can't go. Rudy, you talked about choice. I went to magnet schools. Every kid couldn't go to a magnet school. That was an application process. Ramona, we hear folks say, oh, charters will kill the public school system. That's what was said in D.C. Look at the percentage of kids who are in charter schools in D.C. compared to a traditional school system. Traditional school system is still here. Charter system is still here. What's the problem with both coexisting?
I don't see a problem with both coexisting, and I'm not aware of anyone saying that charters should take over the entire system, although in one or two places, New Orleans among them, that may be being tried. That's certainly not what we espouse. In D.C., about 45% of all public school children attend charter schools. The number is about 39,000, but there's another 20,000 on waiting lists, waiting to go.
So 39,000 in charters, but 20,000
on
who
waiting.
Want to get in.
Yes, yes. Nationally, there are 3 million children in charter schools and over 1 million on waiting lists. Waiting to get in. So it's perfectly true that there are not enough high quality charter schools right now. And there are a number of reasons for that. But we need to be a bit more sophisticated in our analysis because it certainly is not the case here in DC that our schools are not carefully monitored, that the charter schools fall below a standard that's held by the traditional public schools. On the contrary, if traditional public schools were held to the same standards as the chartered public schools, we wouldn't have such a failure rate in the District of Columbia and in other cities that have in fact created the charter school option here. These schools were failing miserably for more than 3 decades before charter schools were provided as an option.
Don, when you hear... When you hear that number, 1 million on the waiting list, that means that folks are saying, what I currently have, I don't like. I want to get into that. And in fact, last year, we conducted a poll. We had Brilliant Corners Research, Cornell Belcher's firm, top pollster for President Obama in 2008-2012, do this poll. And this is exactly what we discovered. We discovered that 74% of Black parents with school-age kids said they would be interested in sending their own kid to a public charter school. 18% said no. We even asked them about the issue of vouchers, 70% favored vouchers, 19%. These were black parents. So what do we tell black parents if the NAACP, Congressional Black Caucus, and black civil rights groups opposing school choice, but black parents are saying, your kids probably go to private school, we only have this choice here, this is what we want to do. There's a problem here because it seems like black parents have spoken. Now, folks, the head of the Howard University School of Education answers that question when we come back. Before the break, I posed this question. How could the NAACP and the Congressional Black Caucus oppose opening more charter schools with a million kids on waiting lists for charters and an overwhelming majority of black parents favoring school choice for their own children? Dr. Don Williams, interim dean of the School of Education at Howard University, answered that question first.
Now, when it comes to the amount of parents that are looking for that option, I beg to differ to say that parents may not really fully understand what's happening in charter schools and what's happening in the traditional public schools. In these charter schools, do they know the graduation rate? Do they know the test scores? Do they know those test scores as compared to the traditional public schools? So many times parents' research is, I'm asking my neighbor down the block, what school did your child go to? Does he like it? Do you like it? I think we're going to try that school. So unfortunately, what we need to do a better job is educating parents on how to access the research to make the best decisions for their children.
Steve, you were shaking your head.
My head's about to explode. If we're not going to be limited by telling the truth, then we're going to have a very interesting afternoon. First of all, said that charter schools are not outperforming traditional schools. That's just not true. The Credo studies made it very clear that when you do like comparisons, that in fact African Americans in general and African American boys in particular outperform. So if the question was a question of quality, then a long time ago the NAACP would be back out there suing the school system, because in New York, where you used to work, 75% of the children who graduated last year from the traditional public schools were not college ready. So if we're going to have an honest conversation about quality, brothers and sisters, let's have an honest conversation about quality. If your concern is the quality of the education, and I recognize that, Sister Dawn, your intentions may not have been this, but I find it offensive for you to suggest that the parents don't know what's good enough for their kids, like they, because they're uneducated and they need to be told. I think that parents know more than anybody on this stage what's best for their children.
And I agree
and
with
how,
that.
And how dare we stand piously and determine what we think is good for other people's kids, while at the same time we move to the suburbs and send our children to either private or suburban schools. All I'm asking for is what we give to our own biological and raised children. I'm suggesting that all we are saying that we believe in school choice. I cannot imagine that there's anybody up here who says that they don't want a parent to be able to wake up and feel comfortable sending her, his, or their children to a school that is best for them. And finally, if the concern is about waiting and seeing, wait with your kids. I'm not waiting with mine.
Well, let me just say, since he pointed at me.
Go ahead. Hillary, then I'm going to go to Siobhan.
Thank you very much. Didn't say wait and see. Said there's a real problem with how it's being done now. That's the point. If you look at the data, you'll see something quite different. What you'll see is that we've lost almost as many charter schools as we've started. One of the biggest challenges, quite frankly.
Hold on. You said the data. What's the source?
A couple of different sources. As a matter of fact, the Department of Education will show you what the closing data is on charter schools as well. They even have a list of schools that were actually registered to start, but never did. So, in essence, we know those are real problems that we still have to address. And don't get us wrong, a little misnomer. Number one is parents do want what's best for their kids, but they need to know very clearly, transparently, what the options are. Charter schools do not offer that transparency, and that's a big problem.
Hillary Shelton of the NAACP just said parents are not getting the honest information they need from charters to make decisions about their kids' education. But do some defenders of traditional public schools think black parents aren't smart enough to make those decisions? Plus, accountability and oversight are necessary for both traditional and charter schools. Each side thinks the other is getting a pass. All that next on our Is School Choice the Black Choice special, right here on News One Now on TV1. The battle over accountability and oversight of both charters and traditional public schools heats up right here at the town hall. But first, Shavar Jeffries, president of the Democrats for Education Reform, weighs in on who gets the power over our school options.
Because at the end of the day, it's unbelievably hypocritical for folks who don't live in these communities, for folks who don't have their kids in schools that for decade after decade after decade, generation after generation, have just not served black children. Move away. So they've made a choice. But then low-income poor people, they somehow don't know what they're doing when they make a choice to find something else. It's unbelievably offensive. And it's frankly, I believe, rooted in white supremacy to believe that parents of color aren't making smart choices and don't know what's best for their children. These parents are brilliant. They're smart. There's a reason they're flocking from these traditional district public schools because they haven't worked. And they're flocking for the same reasons the folks are probably in this room and probably the students at Howard weren't at these local public schools because they've been failing for generation after generation after generation. We talk about oversight. In fact, there isn't the oversight on the traditional district side. That's why the NAACP, which I do respect for in a lot of different ways, given their historic legacy of fighting for our people, but they've been suing districts for 50, 60, 70 years because they didn't do right by our kids. Now we want to say the only option low-income families ought to have are the very schools they got to sue for decades and decades because they're not doing right by our kids. And at the end of the day, what we believe in is that the parent ought to make that decision, not us. Well, these parents know their children better than anybody.
And the
they should make the choice, not people on this dais. The parents ought to be able to make that decision.
And those parents
because he mentioned the NAACP again, may I clarify something? The NAACP sued the public schools and they are misbehaving, and we're suing the charter schools now because they're misbehaving as well.
Well, let's get a moratorium on those traditional public schools that for generations that failed. Where's the moratorium for that? If they've been failing for 40 years, where's the moratorium for that?
Absolutely, I'm with you.
Well, where's that resolution? I'd love to see that.
Brother, that resolution is 50 years old, and we're still working.
There's a moratorium that kids shouldn't go to district schools? There's a moratorium to freeze enrollment until they get it together?
Meet the same criterion that we're asking these charter schools to meet today, the same criterion. They have to have teachers that are educated enough to teach the children.
Thank you.
They must be certified, must make sure they have what they need. We need oversight. The oversight for public schools is much more stringent than charter schools.
Then why have none of these schools closed? If it's more stringent, why has not a district school closed that has been failing our children?
No, it has. As a matter of fact, look under the No Child Left Behind Act and see how many district schools closed.
Elizabeth?
All right.
Thank you. And I'm so glad that you opened with the issue of the NAACP's position on charter schools. And I totally agree. One of the things that has not been mentioned is that charter schools have been around since 1990?
First of all, this is the 25th anniversary
Correct.
Of charter schools.
So their record, and of course, the young lady that mentioned the amount of money that has been embezzled, the malfeasance, the lack of accountability, transparency, and oversight, over $300 million in the U.S. And in D.C., recently, I'm sure millions of that are here.
Elizabeth, actually, I can show you lots of embezzlement. Detroit public school system, Philadelphia, Chicago,
Atlanta.
Traditional
and
public
I do
school
not
system.
Deny
so my
that,
point
Roland,
is, where there's lots of money, you will find embezzlement.
Absolutely. And I don't deny that. But the track record for charter schools, and of course, I'm not here to defend the bad track record for public schools. I'm a public school teacher, I'm a public school student, and I'm an advocate of public schools mainly because of Brown v. Board, the separate but equal doctrine, which I do not want to see us head back to. And what I'm seeing in D.C. is the same type of discriminatory practices during the era, pre-Brown era, I'm seeing with charter schools who are basically cherry-picking and sorting kids. The ones that they want, they take.
That's it.
The ones that they don't want, they basically send back to the public schools.
Okay,
but Roland, my point is this, and I need to make this point.
Absolutely.
I am about quality schools. As a career educator, one with credentials, one who taught because I have a passion for teaching, and one who wants to see that same passion in every school, irrespective of whether it's a charter school or a public school. But what I do not want is a market-based system that is pimping our kids under the auspices of wanting to educate children.
One second, Steve.
Because one of the things that I do want to point out here is unions, the reason why charter schools exist is because of unions. Started the first one as an experiment, not to become what we have in New Orleans, but to become an experiment. Basically to take practices from a charter school and basically populate it in public schools. But right now what I'm seeing is school districts throughout the nation that are losing students, losing public funds to charter schools. Charter schools are sorting, picking, and cherry-picking students, siphoning off dollars, public dollars, but do not want the public oversight or accountability.
And even though
you have someone here who is saying...
One second, one second. One second. I'm gonna come to Ramona and Steve, but I want to go to George. Because, George, you're in an interesting position. You used to hold the job Elizabeth had, head of the teachers union in D.C. You now are a school choice advocate. What caused you to switch sides?
That's interesting question, Roland. And as I sit here and listen to the argument, one of the things that I'm looking at, and let me say when I moved sides, and I used to be on the side that, number one, I don't want anything but traditional public schools. As I examine myself to say, why am I really opposed to anything but traditional public schools? As I looked at it from a union perspective, it was really more about my control and power as a union leader versus kids. Now, as I began to look at, if I'm a part of a system and I'm part of a union that's making decisions about kids, for example, in DC public schools, and Lord knows anybody who was here during the time I was union president, Michelle Rhea and I had some battles. But the bottom line is that if you take the child, and even with the conversation I hear up here today, I don't hear a lot about the child. I hear a lot about systems. Well, here's the bottom line, all right? I start with equity, all right? We can't have equity in education unless we first have equity and choice. Now, we started out this program saying, is school choice a black choice? Well, let me answer that and say that's not really the correct question, because school choice is a black choice. I can afford a choice. If I don't want my granddaughter to go to a poor performing traditional public school, guess what? I got a choice. If I got the money, to put them into a private church school. But when you're talking about, does poor, low-income African-American parents have a choice? If you restrict them solely to the traditional public school, the answer is no. So now let's talk about options. I grew up in a time in the South, in North Carolina, where I had to go by a white school to ride my bus to segregated black school. So in 1954, they said, well, we're gonna give you a choice. I find it so difficult to accept today that we as African-American people are sitting on the stage deciding whether or not black children should have choices. We give them choices in tennis shoes to buy. They can buy Adidas, they can buy Nike. We give them choices in cell phones to buy. And then the most important thing in their life, are we gonna say we can't give them choices? That if you are stuck in a low performing public traditional school, you have no choice but to stick in that school. Now, I don't see charter schools as a all answer. I'm like Malcolm X at this point. Educate black children by any means necessary. That's the bottom line. If it's charter schools, give me charter schools. Because kids have roughly 12 years to get it. And I'm like Martin, we can't wait. We can't wait to fix the traditional public education system for kids to be educated. I'm sorry, we can't wait.
George is right, we can't wait. And that's why I convened this town hall to ask the question, is school choice the black choice? When we come back, Dr. Steve Perry, founder and principal of a charter school in Harlem and Connecticut, charters that the efforts to slow the growth of charter schools guarantee that yet another generation of black kids will be lost. One criticism of charter schools that have great test scores is that while traditional public schools must take every student, charters cherry-pick the best students. Dr. Ramona Eatland, the executive director of the Washington, D.C. Association of Chartered Public Schools, is having none of that.
You know, trading in urban myths is really not appropriate, and that is not true. The Office of the State Superintendent of Education finally has data. We finally have a longitudinal data tracking system that can provide the numbers, and that is not true. It's been perpetrated as an urban legend for at least a decade, and it's just not true. Moreover, 75%.
She said it was not true, the idea of cherry picking.
About the cherry picking, yeah. 75% of all the children going to public schools in DCPS are not going to their neighborhood school. That means that 75% of the parents are choosing an out-of-boundary school or a charter school for their students. These are the same poor low-income families. You want to say they don't know what they're doing when they choose a charter school, but that's just 45% of them. The rest of them are choosing another DCPS school, sometimes coming across the river, taking 3 and 4 buses to get their children somewhere that makes some sense.
Rudy, so the question isn't should you have choice, but rather what are the choices that should be available? What's the array of choices that should be available?
That's the question.
So yes, charter schools are going to exist. Private schools are going to exist. Catholic schools and other kinds of religious-based schools are going to exist. There are going to be any number of choices that will populate what essentially is the marketplace of ideas about public education. For me, the question becomes, what then should there be in those choices that would make them equitable?
Hold on, man.
Now listen.
Give us a definition.
Go ahead. No. Hold on. Because the only way you get out of this Gordian knot is to stop arguing against the proliferation of something that already exists. I'm not saying that charter schools are not, that you don't have great charter schools. I'm sure that yours and lots of other ones are. But there are also a fair distribution of poor charter schools, poorly run charter schools, poorly run management companies over charter schools, in the same way as that has been true in the population of quote unquote regular public schools or traditional public schools. So all I'm saying to you is, listen, we can stand here all day and I can argue about the public education system, which I dearly love and support, and you can argue for yours. But the fact of the matter is, there are three elements that in your schools, I want true in my school. One, you're talking about children. One, I want high expectations for my kids.
Absolutely.
And I want that in the hands of a teacher and a principal and a parent. Second, I want there to be a diverse way into that child's human mind. A multiple set of ways by which you can approach how that young person will learn. Now that's going to mean technology. It's going to have some implications for the facilities. It's going to have some implications for the utility of technology and a whole host of other resources that a teacher should have at his or her disposal. And third, there really needs to be a caring, loving environment. And every single place where I've ever been and seen those three things operating in a dynamic, in a classroom and in a school, I've seen high performance. And I'm saying to you, it's in private schools, it's in public schools, it's in charter schools, it's in a whole host of schools. It's just simply not enough for us to feel that it's equitably distributed.
Steve, exactly. And then I'm going to some of our other panelists. Steve.
So to one of your points, you mentioned that there is choice. When 150,000 children in Texas are on waiting lists, when 20,000 children in D.C. are on waiting lists, when almost 100,000 children in New York City are on waiting lists at all, we keep going throughout the country, just for charter schools, that's just charter schools as an option, sure, then there really isn't choice for everyone because it's a significant number of folks who don't gain access to choice. We are running a system in America that was founded in 1635 with the same DNA and expectations that was meant to keep black people enslaved. And so as a result of sending children to school by virtue of where they can afford to live, we are further deepening the segregation such that we can almost ensure yet another generation will be lost while we put forward a moratorium, while we talk about we support all types of schools. I can say I am not a charter school advocate. I'm a good school advocate. And as quickly as I say that, I'm saying that when the people have spoken, then we need to listen to the people, not the talking heads. We need to stop talking in esoteric terms and talk practically. If we have 20,000 children here in Washington, D.C. who want access to a charter school, they are voting members of the public. Give them access. Provide the opportunity. We need to stop putting our own professional interests first, because I find it interesting to hear an individual defending, on the one hand, a failed school system while suggesting that individual or obscure examples of charter schools that have fallen short stand as the rule when the data doesn't support it. The fact is that if folks on this stage were genuinely concerned about quality, then some of the schools that they are receiving dues from the teachers forcibly from, they'd be first in line to shut down. But since they're not, they have to come up with some rationale to keep those buildings afloat. And so they talk about public education. Well, public education ultimately is determined by the public itself. The public is the parent, not an elected official, not a special interest group who wants to maintain its power. It's a parent who wakes up in the morning and says, I'm going to do all I can to provide my child with the quality of education that I believe that they deserve. I shouldn't have to win a lottery. I shouldn't have to lie about my address. And I shouldn't have to pay more money than I have to afford.
I want to go to Joe, and I want to ask you about that. Because we heard the case of the woman in Ohio who literally was threatened with jail, had to get a pardon from the governor because she used her dad's address. Her dad ended up getting arrested and actually died in jail. And when I interviewed her, it was still stunning to her. We have black parents who are saying, I cannot live in this environment. And we're having this battle. And when we asked those parents, they said, look, all I'm concerned about is whether my kid is going to the third, to the fourth, to the fifth, to the sixth, to the seventh, whether they actually graduate. Joe, speak to that.
The individual in Ohio was trapped in a situation where the educational process has literally stalled. There was no outlet. Just as Brown versus Board of Education for the time was successful, but it was also very limited and restricted because the one elusive element that was not a part of it was social equity. The social equity is the real question in the conversation that we need to wrap our heads around at this point.
When we come back, the town hall heats up as supporters of traditional public schools accuse school choice advocates of deliberately trying to sabotage public education. Next up is Frederick Ingram, vice president of the American Federation of Teachers out of Florida, a teachers union and a powerful force in trying to preserve traditional public schools.
The number one choice in the state of Florida, where I'm from, is homeschool. And so, you know, we've had homeschool, parochial school, private school, public school. But there is a concerted effort to try and dismantle, destabilize, and get rid of the public school. And that is unfair to the 90% of students who attend those public schools, namely being African American and brown children alike. We need to reinvest in our public schools. We're not saying that public schools are perfect, and I hope that you're not saying that charter schools are perfect.
Actually, I don't think anybody's saying that anything is perfect. I think what I keep hearing is that there are traditional schools that do work, charters that do work, traditional fail, charter fail. Focus on what works as opposed to say, well, that might work, but I don't really like it. Because I keep asking, why can't they coexist? Why can't you literally have traditional public schools and public charter schools at the same time?
They absolutely can exist, but I heard at the beginning of this conversation a condemnation of the public schools. And I don't think that that's the way that you get your point across or that we improve schools. If we're going to improve schools, then we have to talk about the good and hard work that is going on in these struggling schools. Some of the best teaching in America is going on in these struggling schools in around our country.
You on that because what I just heard is don't criticize traditional public schools that are working hard, but there are people who don't like charters who criticize charters. So guess what? Folks on both sides are criticizing. It's happening.
But let's understand what and who we're talking about. Remember that
we're talking about largely black kids who are not getting educated.
We're talking about black kids and black teachers and these black schools. So let's talk about it from a vantage point that most of the minority teachers in our country are coming from schools just like Howard University and other HBCUs. We're talking about 50% of all minority teachers are coming from HBCUs. We are inferring a condemnation on the kinds of education that we're putting out to these particular schools.
I would say this here. My position is very clear. Christopher, I want to go to you next. My position is very clear. I don't like bad teachers, bad principals, bad administrators, bad school boards, bad politicians over school boards. Because see, I'm real clear what I don't like. My point is this here. I want what works. And so, if there are traditional schools that work, study it, replicate it. If there are charters that work, study it, replicate it. Magnet, homeschool, online, I don't care.
Remember, when you're talking about a public school, you're talking about the heartbeat of a community. Good, bad, or indifferent. You're talking about the heartbeat of a community. It's not like closing down a business or closing down, you know, something else. You're talking about closing down a school. That's the hope and the opportunity for that school. We should be trying to reinvest in that school, reinvest in those teachers, and reinvest in those kids.
I want to go to somebody who created Charter School Network, founder of Friendship Public Schools here in D.C. Donald Hentz, go right ahead.
What advocates for charter schools, advocates for school choice, period, are saying is that we need quality options for our kids. What we are saying is that we don't have the time to fix a system that has been in decay for 40, 50 years in order to save my child who has 12 years of schooling, okay? And I say that as a grandparent whose grandchildren are homeschooled in one of the wealthiest school districts in America, Palo Alto Unified School District. Understand? My son doesn't feel that the school system works for his children. He has a choice. We all should have choices. No one should say that choice should not be available to a parent because that parent lives in Ward 6, 7, or 8, or some parts of Ward 5 in the District of Columbia. I'm a Washington person, okay? And I just don't believe that. Let me go back to when we started our schools in 1997. The graduation rate in Washington, D.C. was 51%. I felt that I wanted to have some type of impact on that graduation rate. My high schools have a graduation rate of 95%. They didn't just come that way. It took work and lots of work to make it happen.
And do you cherry pick?
That's a bunch of crock. Let me tell you something. There's something in Washington, D.C. called My School D.C. All children in the District of Columbia who want to go to a charter school have to go on My School D.C. and whoever is the first child to enroll, you have to accept. You can't decide who comes to a school. That's been the case. I'm totally unsure where we can cherry pick students. Where does that come from? Urban myth?
And lastly, Donald, first of all, how many schools are now under Friendship Public Charter School?
11 or 12. I'm
11, sure. 12 schools. John Jackson, I want to pull you up, please. And the reason we could say and be real nice about this and say, well, we really are not disagreeing. We're all saying the same thing. The fact of the matter is there are battles that are going on right now all across this country, fierce battles. And there are people, Charter Works has been out there. Hillary has probably gotten lots of emails from them about the NAACP resolution. There are people who are going after other civil rights groups saying, wait a minute, why do you not want to see this? This is a real battle because as we're seeing growth, we're seeing even Mayor de Blasio, when he got elected in New York, I mean, he flat out targeted charter schools and people there saying, man, what are you doing? You have success here. Why are you trying to stop this? There is contention on this issue. How do we get folks to realize that it is about kids, as someone else said, not about a system, not about union contracts, not about who gets a contract, soft drink contract or textbook contract, whether or not our kids are getting educated?
I think we have to, first of all, get beyond the issue. As Dr. Crew already said, choice is here. But we're talking in this conversation about, when we talk about charters and choice, a system that educates about 5% of the nation's students. Let's talk about how we also improve it for the other 95%. Let's get beyond the issue. Let's begin to address the core principles, policies, and practices that are necessary so that all students can have an opportunity to learn.
So if there are 5% who are in charters,
yes.
Well, then why can't we just simply say, okay, of this whole pie, there are 5% in charters, there are X percent in magnet schools, there are X percent in trade schools, there are X percent in these schools, and say, let's accept all of it. Because there are people who do not want charters, who do not want trade schools. That's the battle.
There will always be battles, but not much is accomplished through battles. It's when we come together. For example, dispelling false narratives. The narrative that our public school system has failed the African-American community is a false narrative. Let me ask you, how many people here went to a public school? This is Howard University, the majority. Howard University, one of the greatest institutions in our country, and the majority of those here graduated and finished from a public school. So let's start there. Does that not mean that we need to make some gains? Does that not mean, no. It does mean that we need to address some issue, but it's a false narrative. The narrative starts because when most people talk about whether it's a good school or bad school, we're talking about tests. Now, there's clear data that says that whether or not a student performs well on their test has as much to do with what happens outside of the school than what happens inside of the school. So if you have a system where there's clear economic disparities, the public school system is only going to emulate those. If students are going to school and they're hungry, if students are going to school, they can't access counselors. Let's talk about those things. So the question is not whether or not choice is a black choice. The question is, why is choice only a black choice? Because in white communities, they're not met with this decision because they have the counselors, they have the resources and everything.
When we come back, one take on the inspiration behind all successful schools. What makes a great school? Ramona Eatlin of the D.C. Association of Chartered Public Schools breaks it down.
A charter school leader is someone who has a vision for how to really improve the education of children. They turn their lives inside out to have the autonomy to create a system, and then it's their responsibility to figure out the methodology that will get them there. They can be nimble, as Steve just said. They are not bound by central administration and other systems that tell them they can do this, they can't. This is part of the secret. And when traditional public schools get more autonomy so that the people in the buildings can make some of these decisions, they'll be in a much stronger position. And I would just add to Dr. Crew's point, in addition to the ingredients that you have seen in successful schools, I would add the building has to have a culture. And that culture is defined by that vision. And it's powerful and it's motivating and it brings people in.
Next Friday, right here in News One Now, part two of our Is School Choice the Black Choice Town Hall. And it gets hot over the issue of school vouchers. Some say it is the ultimate vehicle for school choice. Others say it is a death knell for public schools. Folks, education is a huge issue for me, for our community. That's why we're focused on this. Hey folks, Roland Martin here. Welcome to part two of our special edition of News One Now. Is school choice the black choice? There's a war going on in education as to how it will be delivered to our kids. Will it be mostly traditional public schools, or will school choice Charter schools, vouchers, and others have a larger role. Now, choice supporters say traditional public schools have failed black children, that adding charters and vouchers will prevent another generation of kids from being lost. But the defenders of traditional public schools claim that charter schools and vouchers result in unregulated, substandard schools, promote resegregation, and strip cash from underfunded public school systems. So we put together a panel of 16 educators, advocates, and experts at Howard University to share their thoughts on this issue and how contentious it is. And trust me, it got a little heated in our panel. And before we get started, here's a quick recap of what went down in part one.
The traditional public school system has failed us miserably and continues to do so. If it were being successful, then there would be no such thing as a charter school today.
If you look at the data, you'll see something quite different. What you'll see is that we've lost almost as many charter schools as we've started.
I'm seeing with charter schools who are basically cherry-picking and sorting kids, the ones that they want, they take.
It's unbelievably hypocritical for folks who move away. So they've made a choice. But then low-income poor people, they somehow don't know what they're doing when they make a choice.
To me, what is still what's most basic and fundamental, George and Rudy, if traditional schools are doing their job, then there is no fear. There's a reason when you say 20 and 30 and 40,000 people are waiting. And so what I'm trying to understand is if educators are so scared of charter schools and it's 5%, hell, focus on the 95 then. Because if there is failure there, there's a reason people are leaving. Hill Harper made this point blank. He said, if you use the restaurant model, and if you shut down the number, if you say you shut down restaurants because they had code violations, he said, if you applied that to education, it'd be a hell of a whole lot of schools that'll be shut down for violating codes. And none of us would want to eat there. But our kids are going there, and we're simply saying, hey, suck it up. There's a grand plan. It's a 5-year master plan. It's a new superintendent. This thing is going to get better. Now that kid who's in the 5th grade is now in the 10th grade. That superintendent leaves. Now it's a new leader. It's a new plan, 5-year plan. Now by the 5th year, that person's now in their 3rd year in college or 3rd year in prison or 3rd year unemployed. And so at some point, when do we simply say, do you, George? Do you. Charter school, knock yourself out, have fun. But over here, we gonna do what we do over here. Why is this deal? I don't want you doing what you do because you taking my money, and hell, I ain't using my money right now.
Let me respond something to Roland that you asked me earlier in terms of why did I change. One of the things that I learned as union president, when you're talking about traditional school systems, there is a bureaucracy that is like being stuck in snow and getting change done. Now, let me explain. I believe in traditional public schools. I believe that that's a necessity. What I don't believe, and I'm going to be honest, is that most times traditional public school leaders don't have a clue about how to change the public school system into a system that works. Let me tell you what. One of the most difficult things that I ran into as a union president is to try to empower the people who know what needs to be done in their classrooms, and that's the teachers. Most school districts in this country do not empower those who are working directly with the children. Those are the teachers. What they do is they empower administrators. They empower all people at the top to dictate to me as a math teacher in my classroom who sees little Johnny every day what I ought to be doing. And so while we get that fixed, because let me tell you, for public schools to change, you are never going to change until you empower teachers. One of the things that charter schools could do if public schools became open to it is let teachers decide and develop their charter schools within your school system and run the schools, and we won't have to wait forever.
I agree.
For the public schools to change. But if you keep talking about boards of education, superintendents, and other people pointing stuff down to the teachers and say, okay, teach this, it's trial and error. When the people in the classroom needs to be empowered, even allow them to start their own schools within the school system. so that the teachers who know the kids the most can really start making decisions. And until that happens, my faith in the traditional public schools to do it by themselves is not existent. So you need help.
Rhody, then Catherine. Rhody?
Yeah. So first of all, George, to your point, I feel like, I'm not going to take this personally, but I know what the hell I was doing as a superintendent, right? So I don't want you to get it twisted that somehow or another, the fact that you become an administrator or the fact that you become, because I started teaching English as well, right? So don't get it twisted that because you become an administrator, somehow you don't know what the hell you're talking about.
I'm talking about empowering teachers.
I understand. In New York City, we created out of the lowest performing schools, at the time that I was there, were 1,200 schools there. There were 200 of the worst performing schools east of the Mississippi. There were about 600 schools that were sort of at level. If you want to just say this, if you want to be able to look at this in terms of just test scores and reading and math. And then there are another 400 schools, roughly, that were the creme de la creme. Everybody wanted to do a sit-in to be able to get in that school. When I look at the distribution of that, and then I ask myself now, at the time I was there, it's $10 billion budget. I ask myself, well, now how much money and in what communities are we spending this money? What I saw was we had a distribution spending problem. You have a distribution problem. Mm-hmm. Now, if in fact you buy that as a proposition, all I would say to you is that part of the role of leaders, which I consider everybody here to be, is to get together around the redistribution of wealth, the redistribution of urban school money. Exactly. The reason, Roland, that you have this pie problem that you described, why can't we all get along? The reason you have it is that the way government at this point in time and the politics of schooling have kind of coalesced, they've coalesced around the question of, I get to live at your expense, or you get to live at my expense. That does not necessarily make us comrades in the pie. What I'm suggesting to you is, this is what I'm saying, I wanted to basically make sure we actually got this out on the table. Mm-hmm. What I would say to you is, we now as a learned group of people, and as parents who are not here but could be, we are at a point where the country is asking the question, are your children really worth that redistribution? They're not asking how much more it should be. Should it be 10,000, 12,000, or 15,000? They're basically saying, well, listen, as long as you fight me and I'm fighting you, then we don't have to worry about it, because our schools and our communities are basically okay.
They're fine.
Right?
Yeah.
So all I would say to you is this, and this is why I said I wanted to basically try to push this conversation beyond who shot John. I honestly believe, and I think Fred said it earlier, there has been a subtle and maybe not so subtle intent to eviscerate public education in this country at the expense of people who essentially don't vote, won't go out to vote, have not necessarily shown up at school board meetings and so forth. When I was chancellor, I removed more school boards because I got the power to do that, and they should have been removed. I removed more superintendents. Out of the 32, I removed 16 superintendents. I removed teachers. I removed principals. I removed anybody who stood in the way of what you just described as that pie of people who could actually make those choices. Empowering teachers? Yeah, I'm all for it. But I'm not for empowering people who don't know how to teach reading.
That's right.
Thank you.
I'm not for people who don't. So I got to have the money to distribute so that the people who need to learn how to teach reading, brother, hold on one second.
No, I said, go ahead. I'm gonna go to Catherine.
Yeah, okay.
I think I'm next.
Okay.
Huh? I got it.
The principals like this brother right here and other people who are exemplary, right? I need a gazillion of those people to be able to run these more autonomous schools. And then you can essentially lessen the levels of supervision and control. But until you have that, you gotta have some money to invest in public education and stop playing this, well, you know what, you do 5%, I'll do 90%, but the way I'm gonna do my 95% is minus the money I gotta give you for your 5%. That's a crazy relationship.
Elizabeth.
Choice is something I don't think I heard anyone on this stage say anything that suggested they are anti-choice. What I think that we're all saying this, that we want quality schools, quality education for all kids, irrespective of whether they're going to charter or public. And as an educator who came through a public school system, it had nothing to do, and of course, we've seen our schools, our public schools decline. What I as an advocate, as a union leader and teacher, representing 5,000 teachers who are advocates every day. And when they fight, they don't fight for contracts. They fight for rights for students. They want quality curriculum, quality professional development, quality teachers. So Roland, the list that you had, the do not like list, is my list too. We don't like bad teachers. We don't like bad principals. We don't like bad schools. And we don't like bad EMOs. Basically, when they're wrong, okay. What you like
for
a lot
for
of the
folks
schools,
not in the school system, what the hell is an EMO?
Education management.
Thank you very much.
Operator.
Somebody sit there going, I don't know what she's talking about, EMO.
Well,
but I'm just going to let her keep talking.
These are the people
who
basically operate charter schools and sometimes mess up. But
right.
The point is this. We're all saying that we want, and someone alluded to it, Steve and several other people, we've always had choice.
Shavar?
Public education has become one of the very few spaces where we somehow have gotten to a space where the beneficiary of the public good shouldn't have choice. When it comes to health care, the beneficiary can choose a doctor that's provided by the state, or they can choose an alternative where there's a ton of oversight and transparency. Same with housing, same in a variety of other contexts. I don't understand why it is when it comes to education that the parents should only have the choice that the government has decided is their neighborhood of school, particularly when as black folk, we don't have a track record with this government where we want to be captive to this government. And oftentimes we have the same government officials where we can barely drive in communities without being pulled over wrongfully, and maybe we don't survive that encounter. On the other hand, we then want that to be the only game in town when it comes to the education of our babies.
Hillary?
No, we've missed something somewhere. D.C. has something called out-of-bound registration. That means that any student can go to any school within D.C. And let me say this. We talk about people standing in line to get into some of the charter schools. You should see what it's like here getting into some of the higher performing public schools in Washington, D.C. So choice is here. I want to make sure we're looking at
But there are a lot of other places, Hillary, around the country where you have to go to that school that's your zip code.
Well, let me also say this, and I appreciate that point. I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri. Lord have mercy. It was an awful public school system. It was very much the way you described. And the issue of funding those schools was outrageous. As a matter of fact, the way they did is they created something called polygrids. If you lived in a poor community, you had one poor community high school, one poor community grade school, and you had to go to that school, but it's based on property taxes. Connecticut is one of the few states in the country in which they actually accumulate the dollars evenly across the board and throughout the state, one of the few places. We're pushing for a bill in Congress right now called the Students' Bill of Rights, because the challenge is when we talk about funding, and it is important we talk about funding as well. When we talk about funding, if you're in a poor community, there are fewer dollars to pay for that school. Wealthy community, plenty of dollars to pay for that school. The debate we're having right now over so-called school choice, which quite frankly is a misnomer this particular instance. But the problem we're having right now is that we have they have choices that they could have if they want to, and the money needs to be there to be able to do it. We want quality public schools across the board. We want quality charter schools across the board. They have to meet the same standard.
When we come back, two opposing panelists agree on the need for social services in all the schools, but I think both of them are wrong. Welcome back, folks. Charles, is School Choice the Black Choice Special? A student asked the question, whatever happened to that village they say it takes to raise a child?
Well, my name is Ryan Battle. I'm 12 years old. I go to the Howard University Middle School. When a student gets in trouble, like, most likely they're going to get put out of class, which automatically puts them onto the school-to-prison pipeline. And my question is, what happened to the village raising kids that look like me mentality?
Thank you. That's right.
Yes, thank you. And I'm so happy to hear you. Thank you so much for that question, because it's one of the reasons why we are such powerful advocates for community schools. It represents the village. So the community model basically offers all of the components that bridges a community, empowers a community, engage parents, and provide all of those wraparound services
Got
that
it.
Students need, no matter where they come from, no matter what zip code they live
Ramona,
in.
Ramona, go ahead.
Right. Yeah. Not only do schools have a responsibility, many of our charter schools, out of that same funding, where 40% doesn't go to central administration off the top, make the decisions to have psychiatric social workers and others in their buildings to support their kids. And they have a no excuses model, and they take it upon themselves to raise up every child that comes in that door, no matter what the condition they come from. But to say that is not to say that the government should be as poor in its response to the needs of its own citizens in poverty as most of our urban governments
and,
are.
And I will say this, part of this fundamental problem is that what cities did was they cities and counties shut down community centers and provided those services, and they said, oh, just leave it to the schools, but didn't have the resources. So actually what I think, and again, I've heard Randy Weingart make that point, and I understand wraparound services. But I believe what the argument should be is, it should go back to, because this is the problem I have. Look, I got a brother and three sisters who are teachers. And what I keep hearing is, education is the fifth and the sixth thing on the list. We worried about dental care, health care, mental care. We can't even get to education. Educators, unions, advocates must push back against cities and say, reopen the community centers. So when a parent comes in, we say, no, go there for wraparound services. But in this place, is for education. And that's what I think too often we're not doing. If we allow the schoolhouse to become the community center, education will not be the priority like it should be. As a school choice supporter, I believe Dr. Elin is right. Race and class are always present. It's present in the argument around the other major components of the school choice battle, vouchers, which allows parents to spend the money the government allocates for their child's education wherever they want, whether it's a traditional public school, charter school, private, church school, you name it. Now, folks, if you thought the fight over charters was rough, wait until you see the battle over vouchers. That's next. Welcome back to Is School Choice the Black Choice? A special on News One Now. On to school vouchers, an initiative that allows parents to take money from the government, which they allocate for a child's education, for their parent to use it as they see fit at a private school or even another public school. Now, a parent in the audience gets us started.
My question is this. If this educational marketplace, there's a standardization and transparency, right? And I know for certain that my public school is definitely not working for my child, right? Why can't I get some financial assistance from the state that I send my tax dollars to provide this service of education? Why can't I get some assistance from them?
Got it.
So that I can go afford to a school where I know works for my child.
Now, if I could get a Pell Grant or a government grant to go to Howard, Spelman, or Morehouse, is that not taxpayer subsidized?
Sure
yes or
is.
No?
It is.
Yes.
It is. So if that's the case, how is it that we support vouchers on the collegiate level, but to his point, oppose it, middle, elementary school, high school?
Because the objective is to maintain a government system that has failed us so that the employees can keep their jobs.
Not quite accurate.
Because if we went with the will of the people, if we went with the will of the people, then the money would follow the child. And just as a student selected Howard University or Morehouse, they would choose the school that is best for them. And no one in here is calling Howard or Morehouse segregated. There's a fundamental difference between a choice and segregation. Segregation at its root means that you cannot choose, that you are predetermined to attend the school, regardless of what your will, that the parents' will not be done, unless, of course, they can afford to buy their way out of that neighborhood. Howard is not segregated. Howard is a choice. The same as friendship is a choice, the same as Capital Prep is a choice, the same as, yes, public schools are choices. It's a choice. And if we say over and over again that we only support good teachers and we only support quality education, then someone please explain to me why so many of our good brothers in unions have found themselves fighting for the jobs to be maintained of individuals who've been found to have committed crimes and other crimes against children. Further along that line, if we're saying that we care so much about quality, How is it possible to have a school in which 95 to 97% of children are not reading, writing at grade level, yet 95% of the teachers in that school and the administration are found to be performing at or above proficiency? See, until such time as we start having honest conversations about why we find ourselves in a situation, there's nothing at all that stops the adults in the buildings from sitting down, huddling up and saying, we want to be the best neighborhood school on earth or the best school on earth, and doing it. There's no charter school, there's no boogeyman, there's no billionaire standing outside. It's just the people in that building deciding whether or not they're gonna stay late tonight or come on Saturdays or come early in the morning. That's on them.
I asked that question about that, because it's very interesting. When I've had debates with people about this, about the issue of vouchers, people have said, Roland, taxpayer dollars should not go to private entities, but you can use taxpayer subsidies for healthcare to go to private hospitals.
The GI Bill.
Hillary, is it true or not true? I can use a taxpayer dollar, a voucher, call a Pell Grant, to go to a private institution that's not public. Yes or no?
I'm not going to give you a yes or no on that because
you know it's true.
There's a misunderstanding. No. Let me tell you what I'm saying. You know as I know, 90% of all public school dollars come from the state. Only 10% come from the federal government.
No, Hillary.
Tell me my data's wrong. Is my data accurate?
Hillary.
All right.
Hillary.
Yes, sir.
This is the premise that I've heard about vouchers. I do not support.
Then let me help you with that.
The premise is I do not support taxpayer dollars going to private schools.
Oh, I disagree.
And what I'm saying is, I need to understand, why do we accept it on the collegiate level? Why do we accept it in healthcare? Why do we accept public defenders getting public dollars who work for private law firms? But then we say you can't do it for elementary school, middle, or high school. I'm just trying to understand why is that okay, but this is bad.
Let me give you some. First, you got to have some context. Otherwise, you're going to have a pretext.
Go ahead.
In other words, the context is think about how the money's spent. Our public schools are paid for by the taxpayers already. Public schools, 90% of the money for all of our public schools come from the state government. Property taxes overall, only 10% comes from the federal government. Look at the private colleges and universities. Where does their money come from? So in other
I'm a graduate of Texas A&M University, a public college.
Yes, sir.
Money comes from the state of Texas.
Yes. And how much
I was able to get a federal grant voucher to go to a public state university. And what I'm trying to understand is, why do we say that's acceptable for college and not elementary, middle, high school?
I will begin arguing first that so thinking about public schools, number one, they're underfunded. So we're taking money away out of the public schools that's supposed to be the foundation of that community and giving it to a few individuals.
But state colleges are underfunded.
Let me finish. If you look at how the school vouchers are utilized, they give you the premise and the understanding that somehow or another you get this school voucher and you're going to be able to go to the Sidwell Friends of the world and those kind of things. The truth of the matter is the average school voucher is about $5,400.
This is a part of the issue of school choice, because when we talk about dollars following a child, the brother just said, I should have the opportunity that if I'm a taxpayer and I'm putting money into a system, I should be able to say, why can't I get that $6,000, $7,000, $8,000 or whatever
it is, if you're special
to take that and go to this school over here? That's what he asked.
If you're special ed, so here's the interesting part, because it goes even further.
Stephen Rudy.
What actually is happening at the K-12, there are vouchers. There already are vouchers, special education. When a child goes from one school to the other, the money's portable. It's just that they're trying to hold on to the lion's share of it to ensure that the system is maintained. Because today, as this former superintendent will tell you, today in somebody's school system, a superintendent had to sign over that a child was gonna go to a special education placement and they're gonna pay through the nose for that. And in many cases, it could be a private, could be for-profit, private, not-for-profit, but it's definitely locally not gonna be a traditional school. This child may need extraordinary services that the traditional school system cannot provide. That money is going to be spent specifically in a school that is not under the jurisdiction of the school system. So it exists even within today's context. So your question requires even a more specific answer. So if it actually is already happening, and it happens at Decatur, it happens at post-secondary, it happens in public housing, and it happens in all these other places, then why can't a parent decide that if I am going to go to another school, I want to take the $11,000 that would have come to me had I gone to a charter school, a traditional school, I want it to go to the other school that I choose.
Folks, Dr. Steve Perry was pretty clear on where he stands. He favors vouchers. But when we come back, Dr. Rudy Cruz says vouchers are not about choice, but were created to strangle public education. Welcome back. If vouchers can provide parents with a powerful tool for school choice, I want you to know why the former head of the New York City public school system thinks they're such a bad idea. You ran a school system. You had dollars allocated per child. Mm-hmm. Why can't that parent, if X number of dollars is allocated, what was the number when you were superintendent allocated per child? 10,500. Why can't there be a system if that parent says, I would like to send my child over here, I want to be able to get, versus you getting the 10,005, I want to be able to get that voucher and then put my kid in this parochial school or whatever school.
So let me try to answer it this way. The rules of engagement post 1954, the rules of engagement for black people were rules that essentially said, y'all can now go to another school, theoretically a better school, because the law now allows it. And we then trudged off and went to these schools as best we could. We got the best education we possibly could. Our parents made choices based upon that. And the rules of engagement allowed for that to happen under the Supreme Court. The rules of engagement now are rules that essentially say, I want to take my money and go to another school, and I want to be able to take my quote-unquote voucher and spend it there. And he's right. This happens already in special education and so forth. That rule of engagement was made so as to, I believe, eviscerate, in the case of New York City, public education in the city of New York. That was not a rule that was intended to empower people in Brooklyn, which is where they wanted to try this. That rule was, listen, I don't want to spend any more money on the public education system. It is a de facto ruined system. Let it go die. So the strategy for strangulation was a strategy that said, well, let me just allow privatization and the market and the forces of the market to allow people to go take their money and go any place they want to go. Now, here's the outcome of that. So for parents, I live in Brooklyn now. So for parents who are in Crown Heights and they want to take their money and go to Staten Island, those of you who know New York, you tell me at what point, how many black and brown children are going to be able to go from Crown Heights in Brooklyn, New York to Staten Island before Staten Island borough president says to the mayor, too many of y'all coming in here.
Come on, brother. But this is a hypothetical.
But there's
a genuine hypothetical here as opposed to what it is. If you agree that it already is occurring to the benefit of special education children, then how can you then turn around and say that, but if we did it for traditional education children, then it would be for the evisceration?
I'm not even suggesting that you don't. You didn't hear me right. Okay. I'm not saying that you don't do it. I'm saying that the predication, the basis for trying to do it initially, when vouchers first got launched, it was a way of saying.
But that never happened, though. I know you were in the meeting, but it never occurred. This is why we keep talking about the boogeyman, but it never occurred.
Well, but I'm just telling you what the ethos was.
Rudy, go ahead. I'm going to Cristobal. Go ahead.
The notion was, I do not want to equalize the playing field because I don't believe that the 95% are ever going to do anything different. The system is eternally broken, and so I'm just going to leave that alone and let it decay.
but it never happened.
Well, it happened in 1963, and I'll tell you all about it.
It wasn't a mistake.
I can tell you when it happened in Mississippi. I can tell you. It did happen.
That's where the vouchers came from.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much. The voucher school system, as we see it now, was actually perfected in 1964 in Mississippi. As a matter of fact, right after the Civil Rights Act of 64 was passed, and we had to integrate the great central high schools, what they did was is provide school vouchers to all the students. Entrepreneurs built the academies on the other side of town that did have to adhere to the civil rights protections. They took those school vouchers, gutting the public education funding system for the white kids to go to the academies.
You.
They lost everything they
and
fought for in the central high school.
And did the very same thing in Virginia.
Thank you. Shut down the entire state of Virginia.
The state of Virginia was never shut down.
I recall an educator, mm-hmm. an entrepreneur in Chicago.
Right.
Who created her own school. Yeah. One of the most dynamic schools, and we talk about her and laud her. Her name was Marva Collins.
Nor very well.
So you're talking about 1964,
right.
But you've got black entrepreneurs now. But you got black entrepreneurs now who are literally saying, wait a minute, if I could build my own school and maximize the vouchers and teach my own kids, y'all did it, I can do it too. I'm still asking the question, what is the problem, Cristobal? Because here's where I'm confused.
You didn't cut
if I'm serving, because here's the piece, if I'm serving 100,000 students and 30,000 leave with vouchers, that means I'm now serving 70,000. It's not that my system gets shut down, it's just that I now have the budget for 70,000 versus 100,000. That was the same thing I heard about charter schools. The complaint about in D.C., what I heard was, if you do this here, system's going to shut down because the money's going to leave. It's still here. They're simply serving a smaller clientele. Go ahead with your comment.
I've actually been a president of a charter school at one point, of their governing board, and what I saw was great school. We outperformed the district. Wonderful. We were 5% of the state that performed above the public school option, the public school district. The issue was our infrastructure, our leadership issues were there. The system in the state wasn't set up to support those kinds of systems. So the struggle for charter schools is with the entire state system, as well as with the public school system. They're fighting a whole different set of battles. Ultimately, the inequities, when we're talking about the inequities playing out in both charter or public school, we have to beg the question, are we putting our efforts together to achieve fair outcomes? As long as we're not begging the question of fair outcomes and we're just looking at inputs, we're not getting there. Our fight, I love the beautiful crowd here. It's not with each other. It's with the system that we're fighting up against the state, either the federal government, that we're not talking about the issues that improve equity in order for black and brown children to be served to achieve fair outcomes.
When we come back, what vouchers have saved the Marva Collins Academy in Chicago, and how could they help a new generation of black education entrepreneurs? Welcome back to part two of Is School Choice the Black Choice? We're talking about how vouchers give parents a choice for their kids in schools, but also how they could empower the black community. The reason I'm specifically talking about this issue of vouchers is because I know of individuals. First of all, I'll use Marva Collins as an example. Marva Collins decided that she was not going to accept government funds. When she retired, her daughter took over the school. Dwindling numbers on the west side of Chicago, eventually had to close the school down. If there was a capacity for her to be able to have, if the children who she was serving, if those families had the capacity to get a voucher to go to her school, she would have had a full school. In fact, she would have had folks knocking the door down trying to get in. But I'm still trying to understand, why do we have this attitude that you're allocating dollars per student, but we're saying, oh, no, this is not for you. This is for me. You can't touch it. You can't get near it. You can't make that decision. It's all for me, when that's not the same thing in other areas where we spend taxpayer dollars.
Because that empowers black people. And when black people, we have rarely had public systems that were designed to empower black folk with control over resources. So when we talk about parent choice, whether it's in a traditional, whether it's in the public charter sector or even in the voucher context, that gives black people control over resources. The power to decide is power. When you don't have the power to choose, you have no power. And so the system is going to want to hoard that decision-making power, is going to want to hoard the resources associated with that decision-making power, because then they can redistribute those resources to favored constituencies. But when you talk about choice, that is empowering poor black people who have never had power in this country. And so there's always going to be an uphill fight when we want to give more power, more choices, more control over resources to low-income people of color.
Troy, go ahead, Steve, and then I'm going to Troy.
Think of this for a moment. If black parents get to use the money for the schools that they choose, and black people get to start their own schools with public money for the first time since Reconstruction, then imagine the power that begins to unfold for our community. Imagine also what happens for the sense of self that we develop as a community when we no longer have to ask somebody else to educate our children and constantly ask to have us teach our topics to our children. See, what vouchers in particular do is they take those waiting lists and they make them go away. The 2,700 children that were on our waiting list in Hartford are not on our waiting list anymore. The 1,000 children that are on our waiting list in New York City are not on our waiting list anymore. Because now what I'm able to do is I'm able to say, oh, mom, you have the money? We'll just open up another site.
Go right ahead. Go ahead.
I was just principal of the number one school in the city of Chicago, number one neighborhood school. And we often compete with some of the highest profile private schools. And often, every month or so, we got a kid from the private school that got kicked out, that they couldn't quite handle. And we integrated them into our environment. And sometimes it may have been a little rambunctious or a learning difficulty, but we were able to teach them and get them to thrive. And so one of the things that I began to understand about private schools is that the private schools often want kids who can teach themselves. And when they get kids who can't teach themselves, kids who need to be taught, they kick them out and send them to the place where people are trained to do that. What people are trained to teach, they send them to the public system. And so, Roland, your question is based on an assumption. The first question was about the assumption that we don't want vouchers because we shouldn't put public money in private schools.
No. That wasn't the assumption. That is the reason critics have...
That's the reason some do it.
That's the reason a number of people have given as to why they don't support.
I acknowledge that. That's the reason. Your question is based on the idea that that's the only reason. There are other reasons. One of the main reasons is that it's just not good public policy. If your goal is to give the critical mass of children the highest quality of education possible. And when I say highest quality, we have to think scientifically. It means where in a given year, they learn more over the course of a given year than they would in another option. So if I get a kid that's 2 years ahead, and at the end of the year, he's still 2 years ahead, I didn't teach him anything. But he's 2 years ahead and I look good. If I get a kid that's 2 years behind, and if at the end of the year, that kid is only 1 year behind, I just taught 2 years of material in one
year. And what you're describing is exactly what Marva Collins said, how she could take a kid at the beginning of the year who could not read and was reading Shakespeare by the second semester. And what I'm saying is this here, the current system did not allow for those parents to be able to get that voucher to go to her school. As a result, her school shut down. Now those same kids on the west side of Chicago now having to go back into the public school and don't have Marva Collins Academy as an option. So what I'm saying is this here. If he said, I got 2,700 people who I can educate, and he may say, I can do 3,000. George said, I can do 5,000. Then, as kids who are not going into a system where they're saying, I'm not learning, I'm still asking, what's the problem if you're already allocating dollars per pupil? Why can't you take to the parent? If you don't believe that we are doing the job, here you go. You can find another option.
Because it is not the job of government or what government cannot do is to look at the exception to a rule. What I just talked about, getting those 2 years in one, that's more likely to happen in the public system.
I got it, George Parker.
I want to offer an answer to your question that has nothing to do with data.
Go ahead.
When you say, why is it that the vouchers are bad? If we look at everybody on this stage, right? Some kind of way, we began to fight battles based on lack of trust. Has nothing to do with data. If the people who support charter schools, right, looked at traditional public schools and cured a fear that all public traditional educational advocates have, and that is, we are not trying to shut down traditional public schools. If all of the traditional public school advocates look at charter school folks and say, we're not trying to keep you out, we just want everything to be good. If all of the people on this stage could sit down in a room together and decide, how can we do this and include everybody? You could find ways to do vouchers that would be acceptable to public school advocates, to private schools, and et cetera. You could find a way to say, let's work together also at the same time we have charters to help Liz Davis and help other people improve what? The public schools. Too many of us have an all or nothing approach toward the pie, right? And so we don't have any trust in each other. So when you start talking vouchers, I think you're trying to shut down the traditional public schools. When you start talking charters, I think you guys, I'm afraid, because I think you guys are trying to just abandon traditional public schools. So the battles are fought because we don't have any trust. Very seldom are the battles fought on real data. Yes, there are some great public schools. Everybody who is about charter schools should be supporting, maintaining those great public schools. Absolutely. Not just want charters, but there are also some great charters.
Right.
Everybody who are advocates of traditional public schools.
And we agree that parents should have a choice, right, and that choice should be based on data. Because when you think about what drives decisions, data, in order for parents to be informed on whether or not they are choosing a quality charter or public schools, they need data.
Right.
And it needs to be truthful, honest, authentic, real. Parents need to have real data. Right. A lot of the data that parents need, even the ones who made the decision to send their child to a good public or charter school, is based on what information those schools provide. If it's false, spun, they make bad choices.
George, finish your point. And I got one of these questions right here. Finish your point. I'm going here.
Liz has a very valid point, except my only response is this. If you don't have trust in the people who are presenting the data means nothing. So we first got to establish some trust between each other in terms of our ultimate goal.
Question.
My name is Amber Williams, and I am a graduate of a public school in the Mississippi Delta, a graduate of Tougaloo College, where I chose to attend, and now a doctoral student here at Howard University. But what I find is that in this conversation of choice, the key factor that I keep hearing is that the parents can decide. Well, if the goal is to educate all children, then what happens when a student does not have that parent to get the voucher, that parent to send them to a good school? What are we doing for those children on the traditional public school and the charter school sector?
Ramona.
I want to piggyback my response to you with something that I was thinking about before as well. The elephant in the room, obviously, is race and class. And the fact that schools alone cannot and should not be expected to respond to all the needs of all the children we want to serve. The city of the District of Columbia, and I have this conversation almost every time I go down to the district building, the city has a responsibility to do more for the children with the greatest need. In DC, we have a large number of children in foster care and homeless children. Many of them are in charter schools as well as in the traditional schools. And they're only there if Child and Family Services are on their job, or they have extended families who step in and help them. But we really need a much better not safety net, but infrastructure to really support the children and the families who are impacted by poverty and by race here and everywhere else in the country.
When we come back, some final thoughts. All right, folks, time for final thoughts from some of our Is School Choice the Black Choice panelists and me.
Well, I think it's been a great conversation. I think what we got to focus on is there's good practice and there's bad practice. There's good teaching, there's good school leadership, there's good stewardship where schools should be part of their broader communities. And we got to support that wherever we find it. We see that in the public charter sector, we support it. We see that in the traditional public schools, support it. What I believe is that the entity that ought to make those decisions in the context of an individual child about traditional public charters should be that parent, not government authorities. But I do think we need to leave this room united around supporting one another, collaborating on good practice.
Rhody.
We've had a couple, three decades worth of supply-side education. Most of it has been around money, around who gets it, who doesn't get it, and what portion of it do charters get versus public schools get or other public schools get. I suggest that we flip this conversation to a demand-side conversation and ask the question, what would it take for us to create schools that everybody in the Black community or in any community would demand to go to?
All right.
First, let me say that we have to get rid of the excuses. Regardless of whether it's a public school or whether it's a charter school, we have to set the same high standards. We have to pay teachers a fair day's wage for a hard day's work. We've got to make sure our children get the kind of resources they need, and we've got to stop hiding behind the excuse of teachers' unions, quite frankly.
Thank you.
Let me say this.
Say it again.
We've watched how these things work, and those who seem to be most in opposition to teachers' unions are those that simply don't want to pay their teachers a fair day's wage and give them the support they deserve to do a great job for our children. So all of that to say, same standards, same area. We want the same level of accountability. We've got to hold everyone accountable for what they do, regardless of whether you want to call it a charter school, a school voucher, or a public school.
All right. Ramona?
We know a great deal more about how to help children succeed than we do. And what I'm interested in is sharing of best practices, not having one side say, we don't need to know how that successful charter school did it. We'll be all right in 5 years or more. But share best practices, learn, collaborate, and really put into practice what we know. As African-American people, we can do a lot more for our children than we've been doing.
Catherine.
Remember that parents have the primary responsibility for making sure that their children are educated, and they should have a choice as to where they get that done.
All right, then. Final comment is this here. One of the greatest books out there is James D. Anderson's book, The Education of Blacks in the South, 1860 to 1935. And what's very interesting about that particular book, it shows that African Americans were the ones who forced states in the South to actually publicly finance education. When those schools were shut down, you know what Black folks did? Those freed slaves, they started their own schools. The reality is this here. School choice started with Black folks. And so we've always had to demand better educational options. I said it during this forum, and I'm very clear. Am I a supporter of school choice? Yes. I went to all public schools. Clinton Park Elementary School, Pleasantville Vanguard, William Holland Middle School, Jack Case High School, Texas A&M University. I'm very clear. I support traditional public schools, charter schools, magnet, voucher, home, online. I do not care how we educate our children. I have one simple standard. Does it work? I'm not interested in contracts. I'm not interested in drama. I'm not interested in all these fights. All I care about is whether or not Black kids are going to have a future. And the bottom line is this here. If you're in the way of Black kids getting education, I suggest you get the hell out of the way, because we are going to run you over and make it clear that our kids deserve a shot for the American dream. We want to thank all of you for watching Is School Choice the Black Choice here at the campus of Howard University. That's it for this special presentation of Is School Choice the Black Choice right here, News One Now on TV One. I'll see you soon. I'm Roland Martin. Holla!